So to continue with the concept of surface tension, so first of all, we had understood the definition of a surface. Okay. The surface of a fluid is defined as a thin layer of fluid molecules that separates the fluid body or volume from the atmospheric medium. Around it. Okay. Atmospheric or whatever other medium around it. Okay. So we visualize a fluid surface as this thin layer of molecules, okay, at the surface, which is separating the body of the fluid, that is this volume of fluid, from the atmospheric air around. Okay. So this is the surface. So the main difference why we separate the, or, you know, we think of the molecules which are at the surface in a different situation compared to the molecules which are here, is because if you look at it microscopically, if we were to magnify this, then what is happening is that the molecules at the surface, let's say this is what we are defining as our surface. So molecules that are placed here are generally experiencing cohesive forces or intermolecular attractive forces like this. Okay. Whereas if you were to look at molecules which are located here within the volume of the liquid, in the body of the liquid, so molecule placed over here, this tends to experience cohesive forces or intermolecular attractive forces equally from all directions. So molecules at the surface experience cohesive forces only sideways, that is tangential to the surface. And from below, there is molecules in the body of the fluid. Okay. They experience these cohesive forces from all directions. In 3D space around. So this particular thing that we are seeing over here, this nature, okay, this gives the surface and elasticity. So we can visualize the surface like a thin membrane, which is partially elastic. So as a result of this, the surface acts like a thin elastic membrane. Okay. So this was the definition of surface itself. Now, surface tension is a physical property that we use to define this elasticity. Next thing we had seen was that surface tension this is a physical property that defines elasticity. Of its surface. So surface tension it is a tangential force per unit length acting on surface molecules. So if we visualize the surface as a thin elastic membrane, then along that surface or tangential to the surface, there is a sort of elastic force which is acting on the molecules. And that elastic force or that tensile sort of force per unit length, which is acting tangential to the surface. So if we look at the top view of the surface, you'll visualize it like a disk of molecules. So on that disk, so that if we visualize certain line of length L, line of molecules, then it's experiencing tangential force from both sides like this. So that tangential force per unit length, that is surface tension. So surface tension is measured in newtons per meter. Okay, now the next property that we had seen of the surface related to this was the surface energy. Which is basically the elastic potential energy associated with the surface. So we had seen the formula for surface energy. It is surface tension multiplied by surface area. That was another way of defining surface tension. It is equal to surface energy per unit surface area. So therefore, one important implication of this is that surface energy is proportional to surface area. That means that any volume of fluid naturally takes a shape such that the surface energy is minimized. For maximum stability. Because as you know, the lower the potential energy of a system, the greater the stability. Which implies basically that surface area should be minimized. Okay. This is in zero gravity environment, in zero gravity space, body of fluid naturally takes a spherical shape. Because a sphere has the minimum surface area to volume ratio. Okay, now the next property of a fluid related to surface tension we'll see is excess pressure inside of a spherical volume of fluid. So visualize a spherical body of, or a spherical volume of fluid. So it has spherical surface, which is bounding the volume. So the pressure inside always exceeds the external pressure. You can think of the spherical volume as like a spherical drop of fluid. So the pressure inside, and P naught is the pressure outside or external to the spherical drop. So P is always equal to P naught plus 2T by R. Or in other words, the pressure difference between the inside and the outside environment is 2T by R, where R is the radius of the spherical drop. And T is the surface tension of the fluid. So, for example, for a water droplet, surface tension of water, I'll just give you the value. Suppose we have a 1 millimeter radius spherical droplet of liquid. Then we want to find the excess pressure inside. So we will use this formula, that is equal to 2T by R. So just make a note of this first. We'll discuss the question. Okay, just note this down and try out this question. it's 72 millinewtons per meter Chirag. Okay. So surface tension of water is a standard value, 72 millinewtons per meter. So here we will see that the excess pressure, let's say delta P, or the pressure inside minus the external atmospheric pressure, that is going to be 2 into 72 into 10 raised power minus 3. If I express this in SI unit of meter per meter, divided by the radius, which is 1 millimeter. So again, this is the excess pressure. Okay, now one thing you should understand over here is that for a spherical bubble instead of a droplet of fluid, the pressure of the air inside the bubble. Want to find out that pressure. So when we visualize a spherical bubble of liquid, we should understand that it's not the same thing as a solid spherical droplet. Yeah. A spherical bubble, like a soap bubble, for example, it is a thin spherical shell of soap solution, which is hollow from the inside. So such a spherical shell of liquid is bounded by two surfaces, the inner surface and the outer surface. So bubble is like a thin shell. So it's got air inside, air outside, and a fluid shell. Okay. So now if you visualize this, this shell or this shell of fluid is bounded by two surfaces, outer surface. Let's say that has a radius R1, the inner surface. Which has a radius R2. So R1 is almost equal to R2. So what will happen here is that if the external environmental pressure is P0, now consider a point like this as if it has pressure P1 and the inside has pressure P. So P will be equal to, or rather P1 first of all, will be equal to P0 plus 2T by R1. And then P, which is the pressure, internal pressure, that will be equal to P1 plus 2T by R2. Okay, now suppose, and we can see that P1 is equal to P0 plus 2T by R, and P is equal to P1 plus 2T by R. So this becomes 4T by R. The excess pressure So this excess pressure is of the air inside a spherical bubble of fluid. Whereas the earlier example we had seen, that was the pressure of the, this was the pressure of the fluid inside a spherical volume. Okay, so this spherical volume of fluid is like a, it's a solid spherical drop of fluid. Whereas now we're talking about a spherical bubble. Like you've seen soap bubbles that float through air. So the air inside that soap bubble, because it's like a thin shell of soap solution. So the air inside that bubble is at an excess pressure of 4T by R. So just make a note of this also. Yeah, so hope you have finished writing this down. Okay, people. Now, the next related concept to surface tension is the very interesting phenomenon of capillary rise and contact angle. Denote this with the symbol theta c. So, for any fluid surface in contact, you can say, for any fluid surface at its point of contact with a solid surface, the angle made by the tangent to the surface is called angle of contact. So, for example, we have, let's say, a glass container, a cylindrical glass container. Just a moment, people. Yeah, so for example here, suppose we have a glass container with some water in it. Okay. Now what we'll observe is that at the point of contact of the surface of water with the glass wall, we magnify this. What we'll see is, like, let's say this is the side glass wall. And Beside this, we have the fluid surface. So at the point of contact, the fluid surface will have a slight elevation like this. So we draw tangent to the point of, to the surface at the point of contact. This tangent is making some kind of angle to the glass surface. That is called the contact angle. Let's say this point here is P. So P is the point of contact of the fluid surface with a solid surface. In this case, the glass wall of the container. And the fluid surface in this case is the water surface. So this line is the tangent. The fluid surface. So whatever angle it is making with the solid surface, that is called the angle of contact. Now, typically the angle of contact is an acute angle. Most often, this angle of contact or contact angle is acute. Now we'll look into the reason why this happens also. Okay, now let's look at the reason why the contact angle for most liquids is acute like this. At any fluid surface, molecules near the contact point experience cohesive forces, okay, which is intermolecular attraction between fluid molecules, and also adhesive forces, which is the intermolecular attraction between fluid and solid molecules. So to visualize this, just consider that magnified diagram. So this is a solid surface, example glass. And this is the fluid surface. Example, water. Now, the molecules over here, the fluid molecules, they are experiencing a combination of forces. Cohesive force and also forces in this sort of direction, which is adhesive forces. Okay. So, for example, these molecules at the surface here, they're experiencing cohesive forces like this and adhesive forces like this. Okay. So, because in most cases, adhesive forces dominate over cohesive forces, the liquid surface is slightly curved at contact point, and the contact angle is acute, as we discussed before. Just make a note of this point, then we will see the application of this concept to calculate capillary action or capillary rise. Okay, so let's also understand a counter example. In certain exceptional cases, example, mercury surface in contact with glass. The contact angle can be obtuse if adhesive forces are stronger than adhesive forces. So, in fact, in the case of mercury and glass, the contact angle is approximately 135 degrees. So there, the liquid surface in contact with the solid surface will look something like this. Instead, so if you draw a tangent at the point of contact, see the tangent is making an obtuse angle. Okay. But generally, this does not happen. In most cases, the contact angle is acute because the adhesive forces are stronger than the cohesive forces. Okay, so let's move on to the next part. Capillary action. So as you know, a capillary is a cylindrical tube of small radius. So if we insert a capillary into a fluid surface, what we see is that fluid rises in the capillary. So the height by which it rises is called the capillary height or capillary rise. So if we visualize a more detailed magnified diagram of this, a couple of important things that we understand here. Firstly, that the fluid surface is like this. This is what we call the meniscus, okay, which is a fluid surface inside the capillary. It is typically concave. Why it is concave is because at the point of contact, the angle is typically acute. Of course, in exceptional cases, it becomes convex because the angle of contact is obtuse. So if the capillary has a radius r, contact angle is this, okay, and the fluid as density rho and surface tension equal to T, okay, then the formula for capillary rise is 2T cos theta divided by density into radius into g. This theta is the contact angle. So just make a note of this. We will look at a couple of applications. Okay, so that is about surface tension. Now the last and final fluid property we study is viscosity. So viscosity is to do with viscous force, which is a non-conservative dissipative kind of force. That acts such that it opposes relative motion. In a fluid. But the fluid is, in this case, a non-ideal viscous type of fluid. Motor oil or lubricants have viscosity. Okay. Liquid wax has an extreme amount of viscosity. Paraffin. These are examples of highly viscous fluids. So, for example, if an object is moving through a viscous fluid, then it will experience a viscous force. So, an object moving through a viscous fluid experiences viscous force, or this is also sometimes called drag force, FV, such that FV's direction as a vector is opposite to the velocity vector. Okay. So just make a note up to this point. We will continue. Okay, now not only this viscous force is opposite in direction to the velocity, but also the magnitude of the viscous force is proportional to the magnitude of the velocity. And the constant of proportionality depends on two factors, the fluid's viscosity, which is measured as a parameter called coefficient of viscosity. Given by the symbol eta, just like we used to have coefficient of friction in solid surfaces. Okay. And secondly, it depends on the size of the body. For example, radius r of a spherical body apart from the fact that the direction of the viscous force or the drag force is always opposite to the direction of the velocity with which a particle or a body is moving inside a viscous fluid. Also, its magnitude is proportional to velocity, that is magnitude of velocity. Okay, so one important formula related to this viscosity is called Stokes' law. So this is like this, that when a spherical body is moving inside a viscous fluid, it's inside a viscous fluid moving at a velocity of magnitude V. It's moving such that its velocity vector is this V, then the viscous force vector acting on it will be opposite to the velocity in this sort of direction. And its magnitude will be given by the formula So its magnitude will be given by the formula 6 pi eta into r into v, where eta is the coefficient of viscosity of the fluid. It's in Newton second per meter. R is the radius of the spherical body. V is the magnitude of its velocity. So just make a note of this formula. Okay, so one more formula related to this Stokes' law. We'll conclude with this formula today. Is what is called the terminal velocity calculation by Stokes' law formula. So this is for the concept that when a spherical body is in free fall inside a viscous flow, its motion is such that it has a diminishing or reducing acceleration, and eventually it achieves what is called a terminal velocity. That is uniform motion, or its acceleration becomes zero. Okay. So imagine a situation where we have a viscous fluid. So the fluid has coefficient of viscosity eta. It has a density of rho L. That is the density of the liquid. Okay. Now if a spherical object starts from rest at t equal to zero, so then at this point of time, it will experience only two forces, mg and buoyant force. So it will have some downward acceleration. But eventually, after some time, as the body now has a downward velocity, it will experience, in addition to buoyant force and mg, it experience also viscous force. So its acceleration A has become less than A naught, okay? Because the acceleration now is mg minus buoyant force minus viscous force divided by its mass, okay? Where viscous force is 6 pi eta r into v, whereas initially A naught was mg minus buoyant force upon m. So eventually, what happens is it achieves what we call a terminal condition. That is, its acceleration becomes zero. And it is just moving with a uniform velocity, which is called the terminal velocity. Because at this stage, what has happened? The viscous force has become large enough that together with buoyant force, it balances the weight. So the terminal velocity condition here is that the acceleration becomes zero when the velocity becomes equal to terminal velocity. So mg minus buoyant force minus viscous force becomes zero. So now, this is a solid sphere of radius, let's say R, and density rho S is the density of the solid. So just note down up to here. We'll just take a couple of more minutes to finish this section of viscosity so that we can move on to another section of physics next time. Okay, so now by solving this equation, we will get the formula for terminal velocity. Now you can see that mg is nothing but density of the solid into the volume of the sphere into g. Whereas buoyant force, as we know, is density of the liquid into the volume into g. So mg minus buoyant force minus viscous force equals to zero. This now implies that density of the solid minus density of the liquid into 4 by 3 pi r cube into g minus 6 pi eta r into v, but terminal velocity should be zero. So from this relation, we can see that 6 pi eta r into terminal velocity should be difference of the densities into 4 by pi r cube. So now doing these alterations, so we can see that we get the formula for terminal velocity as 2 by 9 density of solid minus density of liquid into r square by eta. So this formula as well as its derivation are important from your syllabus point of view, which is why I have done both, not just the formula but the derivation also in this case. This formula comes from the application of Stokes' law. Okay, so people, that's it for today's session. So make sure you go through this carefully. Viscosity and surface tension, these two final properties of matter that we've discussed. Okay. Next time, maybe we'll discuss one or two numerical problems, but they're direct formula-based problems, mostly from this topic, so very easy. And we'll start the next section of physics.